Welcome everybody to today's lecture on pattern recognition. Here is our topic for today. I consider it to be great fun. We will be talking about the curse of dimensionality. And the reason for us to talk about the curse of dimensionality is, if you recall a couple of lectures ago when we, as you know, so briefly crunched our way through the field of learning theory, we talked about things like the Wapnick-Cervonenkis dimension and saw that when it comes to learning from data and everything we are doing here in this context of pattern recognition is to try to train regression methods or to train classification methods or to train clustering methods. Like in some of these cases the word training is not really appropriate, but what we are trying to do is to do inference from data, in particular with respect to classification. We are given some training set and have to train a classifier and apply that on some test data later on. So long story short, when we discussed learning theory, namely the problem of estimating the parameters of inference algorithms from given data, we came across this notion of the Wapnick-Cervonenkis dimension and saw that there are things hidden beneath the surface we need to be aware of. Back then it was the case that if we want to rest assured that whatever we are doing gives good results, we have to have a lot of data. That is what that boils down to. And now you may be tempted to think, well, if we just have enough data, then everything is peachy. There is something else entirely that can make our lives rather difficult. And that is called the curse of dimensionality, and we'll look into that today. And once we have, you know, worked our way through a couple of examples as to how the curse of dimensionality manifests, and therefore have to develop an understanding of what that is, we will then briefly address techniques we can use in order to address that curse of dimensionality. And now, without further ado, let's dig deeper, dive into the fun. This is Richard Bellman, famous physicist. He was the one who came up with this term, the curse of dimensionality. And we can think of that as an umbrella term that refers to the fact that in high dimensional vector spaces, talking about vector spaces here, there are strange things going on. In a certain sense, the geometry of high dimensional spaces is totally different from the geometry of our everyday environment, which we can think of physically as a three-dimensional space, because there's always an x direction, a y direction, and a z direction. And if we are very generous, then there's also a time direction. But our physical environment is basically a three, or if we're generous, four-dimensional vector space. Three or four dimensions is a rather low-dimensional embedding space. And high-dimensional spaces, you know, when we extract feature vectors from a given set of data, they can easily be of a dimension of 100 or more. So higher dimensions start at, I don't know, 10. We'll see where they start later on today. And these crazy, strange, counterintuitive properties of high-dimensional spaces can actually make our life very, very difficult when it comes to data analysis. There are certain aspects, certain things going on in high-dimensional spaces which we are not aware of because we do not see them in our everyday lives. And so if we are way too naive, these things will distort the results we get if we, once again, naively apply techniques for data analysis. All right. And the way we are going to build an understanding of this curse of dimensionality is by means of examples. So once again, this curse of dimensionality is an umbrella term. It is not something that refers to a mathematical theorem or so. It refers to many things, crazy things that are going on in abstract data spaces, in abstract high-dimensional vector spaces. To get an impression of these many things, there will be a couple of examples. Our first example is the problem of densely sampling a hypercube. Remember that throughout this course so far, I have mentioned a couple of times, let us assume a representative sample of something. Right? Representative in the sense of that we are given a sample of data points. And to be precise, let us think about m-dimensional vectors today. So data points are m-dimensional real vectors. Let's assume there is a sample of these things and it's supposed to be representative. And one way of thinking about a sample being representative is that it covers the embedding space, that sort of for every area in the space from which we collect our data, there is some data points that would represent or characterize that area. One way we can think of a representative sample is that it's dense in a space, in a region of a space that is of interest to us. Now, in this example, the region of space that is of interest to us is a cube. In one dimension, a cube is just a line segment. In two dimensions, it is a square. In three dimensions, it is what we typically call a cube. And in higher dimensions, I cannot plot that anymore. Could come up with three-dimensional projections of higher dimensional cubes, but these are the first three hypercubes. And mathematically, we can say that a hypercube of edge length L, this is L, this is L, this is L, this is L, L, and L. So the characteristic property of a cube is that all edges are of the same length. So a hypercube in m dimensions of edge length L is the collection of all vectors x living in this m-dimensional space, but not anywhere in this m-dimensional space. But let's say the components of these vectors can only assume values between, say, minus L over 2 and L over 2. That would say that we assume 0 is here. Here is minus L over 2, and here is L over 2, and all of this is L. 0 is here, 0 is here, and so on and so forth. So we are interested in hypercubes of edge length L, and say sort of the center of the cube is at the origin in that space. Mm-hmm. Good. If we assume that the length of the edge is 1, so if we assume that this is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, all the edge lengths are 1, then we know that the volume of the corresponding cube will be 1, because the volume of a cube is the product over its side length. Well, in general, we would like, if the edge length is L, and we're talking about an m-dimensional hypercube, would be L raised to the power of m. But in this very specific case of the unit hypercube, which is to say hypercube of edge length 1, the volume will be 1. And isn't that crazy already? Because independent of the dimension we are talking about, that thing will always have a volume of 1. Let's go back. So this has a volume of 1. This has a volume of 1. This has a volume of 1, and so on and so forth. Funny, funny. But what we are really interested in is the question of what does it mean to be a representative sample inside such a hypercube. So in a one-dimensional space, hypercube is just a line segment of length 1, we could say, let's sample that cube. let's pick a couple of points inside that cube, and you know, let's be that sample representative in the sense that the points are more or less equally far apart from each other, so that when we pick a certain point, we are sure to cover a certain area in that hypercube. If all the points were around here, we would not have any representative over here. So in that sense, sample can be thought of as being representative if we sort of space these sampling points in an equidistant manner, so that we are guaranteed to have a glimpse at every or at a couple of regions inside that hypercube. Right? If we do this here for this one-dimensional hypercube and we take 10 points and space them evenly along that line segment, that is the one-dimensional hypercube, then we can compare the distances between points, we can actually compute the distances between all pairs of points, and let's say we fix this one to point 1 and then go for all the distances to the others, and we would say, okay, so what is the minimum distance between point 1 and the others? Would be about 0.1, and in fact, if we fix this one to be x2 and then have this one on, as we go for the minimum distance of x2 to all the others, we would find it's again 0.1. Long story short, on average, the shortest distance between any two points here, you pick any two points, compute their distance, and on average, you will find that this minimum is about 0.1. Mm-hmm. Now, that could be a criterion we might have in order to define what it means to be representative or what it means to be a dense sample. Let's say, on average, any two points should be 0.1 apart inside that unit cube. Okay, let's go for the 2- and 3-dimensional unit cube. Well, I'm not writing down the math, but I hope you would believe me if I say that if we want to have an average shortest distance of 0.1 in the 2-dimensional cube, we need 100 points for a dense sample. And if we want to have an average shortest distance of 0.1 in the 3-dimensional cube, we would need 1,000 points. Can you intuitively follow that argument? Because this is a one-dimensional hypercube, and we basically have to make 10 copies of that to densely cover the 2-dimensional hypercube. Well, if this is a dense sample of the 2-dimensional hypercube, we have to make 10 copies of that to densely sample the 3-dimensional hypercube. And then, of course, using induction, it is somewhat clear. I can make all of this very precise. I'm not. What I'm trying to do today is to provide you with new intuitions about things you may not have been aware of. We can use mathematical induction and would find that in m dimensions, so let's say m equals 15, 5 million or whatever, we would need 10 to the m points to maintain this sampling density of minimum, average minimum distance is 0.1. Yeah? Huh. Is that crazy or not? Because the volume is always 1, but the number of points we need to densely sample that volume grows exponentially. So in a sense, what is happening here is that stuff becomes denser in higher dimensional spaces. Right? In the one-dimensional unit cube, we can put 10 points into a volume of 1. And in the three-dimensional unit cube, we have 1,000 points in a volume of 1. This is crazy. And the really crazy thing is that that does not hold in general. We'll see later on. But this is the first strangeness we have encountered, that even though for the hypercube the volume is a constant, regardless of the dimension the cube is embedded in, there is exponentially more stuff in it when it comes to higher dimensions. Let us repeat this exercise, not so much with respect to the kind of stuff that is contained in a volume, but with respect to the volume itself. And let us repeat this exercise with respect to two other geometric objects. The first geometric object we will continue now is the simplex. And we have talked about simplices at the very beginning of this lecture series, and so you are not shocked to find that I am now defining the M simplex. It's like slightly different from the definition I used a couple of weeks ago, where I talked about the M minus one simplex. But look, that the difference of one is still there, but I didn't want to carry around the minus one in here, so I put it here. It's okay. But so the simplex we already talked about is the set of points in Rn plus one such that all the coordinates of each of these points are greater or equal than zero, and they have to sum to one, right? And here is the two simplex, it's just a line segment. Here is the three simplex, it's a triangle. This is funny, the four simplex, it is a four-dimensional object, but we can plot it in 3D. It's the only object where we can plot a four-dimensional thing, really can plot it in 3D. And from four dimensions onward, cannot plot it anymore. But this is how simplices look like. A lot is known about simplices. In particular, we have nice formulas that give us their volume. And we've been talking about unit hypercubes. Now let's talk about unit simplices, which is to say, in these cases, the edge lengths are always square root of 2. Convince yourself that that is true. Basically, go back to what was it, lecture 3 or so, have a look at what we said about simplices back then. Verify that for the standard simplex, the edge length is square root of 2, but of course we can scale the simplex, right? Make it slightly smaller, such that the edge length becomes 1, so to be in the same realm as the hypercube of edge length 1. And for M simplices of edge length 1, we can show, I'm not going to do that, that the volume is given as the square root of m plus 1, m is the dimension of the embedding space, over m factorial times square root of 2 raised to the m. That is the volume of a simplex, and let's accept that as a mathematical fact of life. And the next object we are going to look at is the unit sphere. I'm not plotting them because in 2D spheres look all the same. It's basically a circle, like a circle or a sphere, but if I plot a sphere, it looks like a circle. And then of course there are four-dimensional spheres, five-dimensional spheres, which I can plot anyway. So spheres are those geometric objects, and again, let's assume that the center is at the origin. It's basically the set of all points x in the embedding m-dimensional space, such that the length of the point, I should have put a, it's r squared, so I would, so that the length of a point, or the norm of the corresponding vectors, here I square it, is less than r squared. Of course I could put square roots on both of these things, but let's not do that. This is a sphere, right? We don't have to talk about this. We can also derive an equation for the volume of a sphere. Basically, the sphere in m dimensions of radius r would have a volume of pi raised to the m over 2 times r to the m, and all of this has to be divided by gamma of m over 2 plus 1. I'll talk about this gamma function on the next slide. Looking at that equation, we realize that if we set r equal to 1, so unit sphere, this equation for the volume of the sphere simplifies to pi raised to the m over 2 over gamma of m over 2 plus 1. So great, we have an equation for the volume of a cube, we have an equation for the volume of a simplex, we have an equation for the volume of a sphere. Before we compare those things, let me talk about the gamma function. This is how the gamma function is defined. Are you familiar with the gamma function? Well, if not, it is one of these special functions. And we have, you know, talked about special functions a couple of times already. This is how it is defined. There is no way for us to simplify that integral. Well, we can evaluate it, but we cannot come up with a closed form algebraic representation of that integral. This thing is a special function. That is how it is defined. Funnily enough, it is defined for all complex numbers except for the negative integers. Those are diverging points, but let's not look into this. What this gamma function does is it generalizes the idea of the factorial from integers, like from the discrete points, to the continuum. Right, we know that 1 factorial is 1, 2 factorial is 2, 3 factorial is 1 times 2 times 3 is 6, 4 factorial is 24, and so on and so forth. And the question could be, what is 2.7 factorial, or 3.5 factorial, or minus 1/2 factorial? And the answer is this. And this gamma function plays an incredible important role in all of mathematics and the natural sciences. Here we encounter it when it comes to expressing the volume of a sphere. If you have never seen it, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of these kind of integrals. We cannot, you know, manipulate them any further to simplify them, but we can work with that. Don't be afraid of special functions. It generalizes the idea of the factorial to the continuum. Couple of things, so therefore, like, no big deal. Gamma of 1 should be 1, right? if that really is a generalization of the factorial. We know that gamma of 1 over 2 is pi. Here is a funny recursive property, but this is just a reflection of the fact that it generalizes the factorial, because gamma of t plus 1 is t times gamma of t. And indeed, if t is an integer, then we have that gamma of n is exactly n minus 1 factorial. So don't be afraid of that thing. It is just a generalization of the factorial, which is only defined with respect to integers. Now, we've seen an equation for the volume of a unit hypercube. We've seen an equation for the volume of a unit simplex. We've seen an equation for the volume of a unit sphere. We can now ask the question, so what if the dimension of the embedding space becomes very, very large? For the unit hypercube, we've already seen, well, the volume is always 1. It's a constant, regardless of the embedding dimension. If we consider the equation for the volume of the unit simplex, and let m approach infinity, then the volume will become 0. If we do the same with respect to the volume of a sphere, and let m, the dimension of the embedding space the sphere lives in, approach infinity, the volume becomes 0. Isn't that crazy? Like a sphere, like a circle, a ball, is definitely not a zero volume. Why should a 1 trillion dimensional ball have basically no volume anymore? But it is like that. It is like that. And it's even crazier. Here I'm plotting dimensions actually from one, I guess, yeah, one, zero dimensions, very, very uninteresting, to dimension 25. And the volume of the cube is always one, the volume of the hypercube, unit hypercube, I should say, is always one. The volume of the unit simplex quickly decreases towards zero. And look at this crazy sphere thing. A five-dimensional unit sphere has the largest volume. And from there, it's downhill. Look, from our everyday environment, we say, okay, so a point is, you know, zero-dimensional sphere has basically no volume. A line segment, which we can think of a one-dimensional unit sphere, has a volume of one. Two, like the right radius is two, so whatever. And then we have the circle, and then we have a real ball, and the volume always increases, you know, according to our intuition from our daily lives. And it stops at three dimensions because we can't intuit above three dimensions anymore, because that is not the world we're living in, but, you know, begins to increase. So why shouldn't it increase forever? In fact, it only increases until dimension five, and from there it becomes small and rather quickly, and then in fact is zero. That is crazy, right? And there is nothing I can do about it. It's just, you know, it's like that. But it is even crazier. Let us consider the following setting. So this here is a sphere, and this time I'm using two-dimensional spheres to sketch the idea, but of course this idea works in arbitrary dimensions, right? We have a sphere of radius r, and inside that sphere is another sphere, and it has a slightly smaller radius, let's say r minus epsilon. And this looks like a rather large, smaller radius, but you know epsilon is a placeholder for something really small. I'm exaggerating that in this sketch here. This is the setting we are now considering. A sphere, and inside that sphere is another sphere, and it's slightly smaller radius. We are not so much interested in the two spheres, but in their difference. Let's call that the shell of the larger sphere. So this is the larger sphere, and there is, you know, some region needed to the boundary of the sphere. Let's call that the shell of the sphere. It's like with an egg. The shell of an egg is not infinitesimally small, but there's something there, right? So like that, it's the shell of a sphere. Now, what can we say of the volume of that shell? Given what we discussed about the volume of a sphere, we know that there is an equation that gives us the volume of the outer sphere, and of course we can sort of apply the same equation to a sphere of radius r minus epsilon to get the volume of the inner sphere. We subtract these two things and we get the volume of the shell, right? Good. Now, this is just my way of expressing this volume of the sphere. It's Vm times r to the m. Note that this time it's not so much about unit spheres. Let me go back to this one here. So this here is now called Vm, and the volume of the m-dimensional sphere of radius r is Vm times r raised to the m. There is no dependency on r in here, so therefore we can actually express this as Vm times r to the m when it comes to the volume of the outer sphere, and Vm times r minus epsilon raised to the m when it comes to the volume of the inner sphere. All right? And what we are really, really, really interested in is the ratio. So we are interested in the question, what is the ratio between the volume of the shell? What is the volume of the shell with respect to the volume of the sphere, like the outer sphere? Plugging in these equations we ever so briefly derived, we find that this ratio is 1 minus epsilon over r, and this has to be raised to the power of m. This is just really just plugging in, so this vm cancels out, and then we have rm over rm. The ratio of this shell to the volume of the sphere boils down to that. Now let me go back to here once again. That is to say, we are interested in the ratio between the shell and the whole thing, the whole outer sphere. Looking at that, it looks as if the volume of this versus the volume of all of this is a rather small number, right? Because this shell is just a tiny fraction of the outer sphere. Everybody agrees on that, right? Note that this is a two-dimensional picture. Our question now is, of course, by now you should see the pattern, what happens if this m becomes large? Right now we looked at a picture where this was 2. Now let's see what happens if the m becomes large. I consider this to be shocking. So, for where is it? 2, somewhere around here. You know, it's really like the shell is very much less than the whole sphere. But now I have to go for really high dimensions, right? Really high, you know, 1000 is not that high. But what that graph tells us is that for higher dimensional hyperspheres, all their volume is concentrated in this shell. Because the ratio between the volume of the shell and the volume of the sphere itself approaches 1. Which is to say that the volume of the shell is the same as the volume of the sphere. In high dimensional spaces, and this begins about, I don't know, somewhere here, 600 dimensions or so, hyperspheres are basically empty, mathematically empty. There is nothing in there. There is nothing in there. All the volume of a high-dimensional hypersphere is at its boundary. This is so totally not what we know from our everyday lives. Right? What we know from our everyday lives is this. Like, the shell is tiny compared to the whole thing. In higher dimensions, this is not true anymore. Now, what does this imply for all our work on pattern recognition? And say we are talking about 5,000 dimensional feature vectors, right? Like some feature vectors of dimension 5,000, and I don't know, somehow they live in some, you know, we can always come up with an enclosing ball. You give me a couple of points and there will always be a sphere that encloses them. This tells us that in very high dimensions, well, very high, I mean, this is way less than a trillion, all right? But in higher dimensions, all the data points we are given will basically be living on a sphere. And there's nothing inside. Of course, the mean of all these data vectors will be somewhere inside the sphere, but it will be a very, very poor representative of the data. You have a question?
Yeah, could you perhaps specify how large
Oh, it's tiny. It's really like some epsilon. It's really this is, you know, it looks like something large, but mathematically epsilon is a placeholder for something really, really small. Pardon?
It's stated in the next graph.
Yeah. Look, it really doesn't matter. Because this well, you know, if we raise that to the power of m, that goes away. This quickly, like, really doesn't matter what that epsilon is. It quickly goes away if that m becomes very large. Because this here will always be a number less than 1. Right? This is 1 minus a fraction. This here is a number between 0 and 1. 1 minus a number between 0 and 1 is a number between 0 and 1. If we raise a number between 0 and 1 to something large, it's basically 0, independent of that epsilon. And yeah, that's it. In higher dimensional spaces, everything is at the boundary of a sphere. Like, you give me a couple of points in 1,000 dimensions, and I know they will be on the surface of a 1,000 dimensional sphere. There's still, it's like that.
I just have a question.
Yeah.
Why do we so you say it's to always be on the surface or on the shell? Why are we visualizing it like this?
Oh, so we cannot visualize that, right?
I don't know. Actually, I don't know.
How would you visualize a 1,000 dimensional point?
It's part of the question. So
yeah.
Maybe if we visualize a 1,000 dimension sphere,
yeah,
it would be like something that actually only exists, contains the shell.
This is exactly what I'm saying. You know, the 1,000 dimensional sphere is basically just a shell. This is what this says. This graph shows us, right? And this really raises problems because we cannot believe that. In the world we are living in, there is nothing that would indicate this. Right? This is so counterintuitive. We cannot wrap our minds around that. And this is, I'm glad for your question, because it shows the problem we have when we try to map mathematics to our daily experience. Right? It is a good idea, because mathematics is abstract, and if we can think of it in terms of metaphors that help us thinking about stuff, then that is good. But here is a mathematical truth that is so counterintuitive to our everyday experience that we cannot wrap our minds around this. We really have to believe the mathematics. This is in a certain sense not just something we have to be dealing with in this area of artificial intelligence, machine learning, pattern recognition, data science, whatever name you want to give it. So of course, what creates the difficulties in physics, right? Because we are living on a small ball racing through space, and the largest extensions in this universe are 10 to some rather large number, 20, 30 something. The smallest extensions in this universe are 10 to the minus 20, 10 to the minus 30 something. And we live in the world of 10 to the 1. And it's very, very difficult for us to understand what's going on in terms of 10 to the 30th or 10 to the minus 30th. This is, we have to trust the math. It is beyond our daily intuition. And I'm really going through these examples just to raise awareness for the fact that it is not necessarily a good idea to, let's extract a couple of numbers, let's extract another couple of them, let's stack them together, and now we have a 50,000 dimensional feature vector to describe the problem. Really, let's do pattern recognition on 550,000 dimensional vectors. they will be happily living on the shell of a very high dimensional sphere, and one is over here and one is back there, and then they say let's go for the mean of that, and that mean has nothing to do with all the data. Stuff like that is really, really counterintuitive, so you need to be aware of that. And there is really like, I can just point it out, I cannot do anything about it, and in particular I can really not assist you in coming up with pictures of this, because this is the whole point of this exercise. There are no pictures for this. This is beyond our intuition and daily experience, but it is there. Okay, let's continue with this. We've already talked about things like nearest neighbor classifiers or a k-means clustering, where distances play a crucial role, distances between data points. And then I always had like these two, or if it was generous, three-dimensional plots of examples. And now I have to hurt your intuition once again. We just saw that in high dimensional everything lives on a surface. Like every finite sample of points will form a collection of points on some shell of a sphere. Let's ask for the average distance between a couple of points. Let's come up, for instance, unit cubes again, one, two, three dimensional unit cube. Let's sample 10 points, not equidistantly spaced, random points within the unit cube. And let us ask for what is the average distance between any two points. Not the minimum distance, average distance now, right? Here are 10 random points in the 1 cube, 10 random points in the 2 cube, 10 random points in the 3 cube. I find, I really computed it here, you know, average distance is 0.33. It's 0. something because it's the 1 unit cubes here. 0.59, 0.64. seems to be growing. Makes sense from our intuition, right? Because there's more space in the three-dimensional cube. And the volume is the same, but it's denser, so there's still more space. The points can cover, so they can be farther apart. And actually we saw, yeah, with respect to the shells of spheres, it seems to make sense. This effect of the growing expected difference does not depend on the number of points. Repeated it here with 100 points. Funnily enough, it's again 0.33. Here it's 0.54 and 0.68. This was with 100 points. And just to be sure, I did it with 1,000 points. Average distance is 0.33, 0.52, 0.66. So this phenomenon of growing average distances does not seem to depend on the number of points from which we compute the average distance. We can actually, you know, take this to the extreme. Why? You know, I have here focused on whatever, something here. One, two, three dimensional. Know that now I actually have to go to logarithmic plots, right? So I have a logarithmic dimension here. So this is dimension 10, dimension 100, dimension 1000. And I have logarithmic average distances here. So what I'm plotting here is actually three curves. The fat blue one is the average distance. This is the thing we looked at here. And from these couple of examples, we sort of saw that it appears that this average distance between points in the unit hypercube grows with dimensionality, and in fact this is what we find here. The average distance grows, so the fat blue curve grows. The really shocking thing, however, are the other two curves. This upper one is the largest distance I found on average. So what I did is I had a hypercube, I sampled I guess 100 points, and I did that So I had a hypercube, sampled 100 points, computed the largest distance between any two points I could find, the smallest distance between any two points, and the average distance. Right? So hypercube, 100 points, created a couple of 100 points so to get averages. And then I increased the dimension and repeated this average distance, what is the expected largest distance, the expected smallest distance, and so on. This is the largest distance, this is the smallest distance. Like in low dimensions, it appears that average distance between points is something. The largest distance between points is, of course, larger than the average. And the smallest distance between points is, of course, smaller than the average distance between points. And here, the crazy curse of dimensionality sets in at about, 100, it depends, it's not a clear mathematical thing to talk about the curse of dimensionality, but at some dimensionality, we see, damn it, the largest distance is exactly the average distance, and the smallest distance is exactly the average distance. It never happens in our daily lives. But in, 10,000 dimensions, you give me 100 points, we compute the largest distance we see between these points. It's some number. We compute the smallest distance between. It's the same number. They're all equally far apart from each other. That is what that says. That is what that says. They're all equally far apart from each other in high dimensions. This never happens in our world. On a simplex.
Nothing is nothing. But if you evaluate two people and two factors, it's easy to find the differences. But if you take
this is because you represent those factors in terms of the vertices of a simplex. Right?
Yes
you do. And so therefore, yes, there it can happen. Like let me go back. The object we know where everything is at the same distance from one another is this one. This is a simplex, and here every vertex of this simplex has the same distance to all the other vertices. Right? And we do questionnaires and encode people in terms of these qualitative data. We represent them in terms of the vertices on the simplex. So yeah, there it happens, but if you do some measurements with a yardstick or so, very unlikely that you will find that the smallest distance is the same as the largest distance, which is to say it's the same as the average distance. In high dimensions, that happens regardless. There's nothing we can do about it. Which is of course to say that in high dimensional spaces, a random sample of points will be a simplex, or will be the vertices of a simplex. And of course, let me go back to this here, that all ties in with what we discussed so far. There's always a surrounding, here is a surrounding circle, here is a surrounding sphere. But this is exactly what we found when we looked at this phenomenon with respect to the shell of the sphere. Right? It repeats in different disguises. Okay, let's continue with that. This is so crazy, all of this. Let's consider a point x and x plus epsilon. Epsilon now is a vector, but it's a small distortion. So here's a point x, and here is a point x not far away. We can ask for the expected difference between x and its slightly distorted version. Of course, if we look at that, this boils down to what is the expected size of the vector epsilon, like this tiny thing here. So we have I can expand this squared norm as the sum over all the entries of epsilon squared, and in m dimension I would have to sum from I equals 1 up to m. Expectation of the sum is basically I can move this expectation into here. It's linear with respect to summation, and summing from I up to m is basically to say m times the expected value of the ith entry of epsilon. And if we say that this epsilon I, each entry of this distortion vector is rather small, then its square will be something really small, and on average that might be a small number, right? But we have to multiply it by m. And even if this is a small number, say 0.00001, and m is 10 to 2 billion, then 0.001 has no effect on this m whatsoever. Right. Which is to say that in high dimensional spaces, the idea of a tiny displacement of a vector is not necessarily a tiny displacement of a vector. Right. And we cannot even picture that, we would think. But we actually can. Let me show you what that means. These are three vectors, and of course they are digital images, right? And those are images of 256 pixels times 256 pixels. So we can think of them as a vector in a 65,536 dimensional vector space. Do you agree? Right, we have 256 times 256 pixels. We can unfold this matrix by stacking its rows or columns, depends on what you... Let's say we stack the columns of this matrix one after the other. We get a very high dimensional vector. We have three such vectors here. Now, is this one more similar to that one than this to that? Yeah, we would say so, right? I mean, like this is a checkerboard, this is a slightly distorted checkerboard, and this is a constant gray patch. Okay? So, in a sense, we can think of this like x and x plus epsilon, and this is something else, y. Right? Because it's obvious that this here is a sort of distorted version of that. Well, this is also a distorted version of that where we have recolored all these darker checkers, but look at this. So imagine you are an image retrieval system and the user gives you an image and says, I want to have pictures that look like this. And you have a reference database. In our case, it contains only two references and you're supposed to return the most similar one. Okay? And in that sense, we as human beings would say, well, this is really like nastily noisy, but it is similar to the query image. Mm-hmm. Let's compute the Euclidean distance between these things. This is shocking. Of course, I had to play around until I found a dimension where that works. but look at this. This thing is farther away from this thing in terms of the Euclidean distance between this vector and that vector than this is from that. So this notion of Euclidean distance as a similarity measure is dangerous. It works very well in our three-dimensional world. But if you naively have, I have this database of 1 billion dimensional entries and there is a new entry and I need to look for the most similar one and let's go for nearest neighbor classification, closest Euclidean distance, you are lost. There's no guarantee that this nearest neighbor criterion with the Euclidean distance will work. And there's nothing we can do about it. We just have to know this. We have to know this. Let me speed up a bit. Let's look at inner products between random unit vectors. That is, let's look at two vectors x and y living in an m-dimensional space. Let's say they are independent, so the one vector has been generated according to some process and the other vector has been generated according to some process but without knowledge of x, So Y is, Y, X is being creates, I don't know, m-dimensional Gaussian random vector, and then Y is another m-dimensional Gaussian random vector without knowledge of the X. Right? So they are independent in that sense, but they are both Gaussian random vectors, so we could say on average, or the expected value we would expect for any of the entries of these vectors is zero. And we might then ask for what is the expected value of their inner product. This is what we're going to do here. And it turns out that is going to be zero if the dimension is high enough. Right. So the fat blue line, again, is the average inner product I can find. So what I did here is I created in low dimensions, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on and so forth. I created, whatever, what was it, 100 or 1000 two-dimensional vectors, Gaussian random vectors. Then I computed the inner product, pairwise inner product between them. I looked for the largest one I found, for the smallest one I found, and for the average. Then I did that in three dimensions, in four or five, and so on and so forth, and I get these curves. The average is always like zero, but once again, the largest value of the inner product and the smallest value of the inner product, if the dimension is high enough, approach the average. And that does not only work for Gaussian random vectors, it also works for uniform random vectors when the expected value of their entries is zero. And so I generate a vector, I generate a random number between 0 and 1, then I subtract 0.5, and I generate, I don't know, 10 to the 5 numbers, and I have a random unit vector of expected value 0. The value of the inner product in higher dimensions, on average, is always like 0 in this setting, but in higher dimensions, it is guaranteed to be 0, because the possibly largest value we can find, and the possibly smallest value we can find, approaches the average, and in high dimensions, like 10,000 dimensional random vectors, you take any two of them, compute their inner product, zero. It's another reflection of the fact that those points will live on a simplex. But this is to say that in higher dimensions, everything is perpendicular to one another. We can actually I could have predicted that mathematically, right? Can say, so if we have two random vectors where the expected value of the entries is zero, we can define a random variable z as the outcome of the inner product between any two vectors. We can ask for the expected value of z, which of course just the expected value of the sum where I ranges from 1 up to m, xi times yi, this is the definition of the inner product. Then the expectation is a linear operator. I can move it into the sum. Here is something I can only do because we said x and y are independent. And a couple of weeks ago, I asked you to verify that at home. I mentioned it in one of the assignments. I didn't actually do it. Here is this, from here to here, only is allowed because I said let's x and y be independent. This is nothing that holds in general, but in our setting it holds. Right? In our setting it holds, so I can sort of move the expectation actually into the product because of independence. I know that this is zero, this is zero, zero times zero is zero. So theoretically we would expect that. And then what we saw on the previous slides is basically an empirical verification of that. And empirically we would say, so the expected value sample mean we would get for this inner product in m dimensions is 1 over m times the inner product. And then there is something that's called the law of large numbers, which is to say that the sample mean approaches the expected value. So yeah, we knew that, right? Mathematically we know that. However, it is good to see it. In high dimensions, stuff becomes perpendicular. But that does not necessarily hold in general. Let's repeat exactly the same exercise, but this time, instead of with random vectors, with random binary vectors. That is to say, I will now create m-dimensional vectors that are binary, either 0 or 1. Right? This is something we can, of course, you know, random vectors of that nature can be thought of as Bernoulli vectors. Right? Every entry in such a vector results from a Bernoulli distribution. We've already talked about Bernoulli distributions. So we can say that the entry in Xi is Bernoulli distributed with the parameter p. It's the probability for entry Xi being 1. And we can again consider the expected value of the inner product. This time I'll do the theory first. If we look at two such vectors x and y, look at their inner product, this is the sum over all the dimensions, ith component of vector x times ith component of vector y. Xi and yi are both Bernoulli random variables, so we are interested in the probability distribution of the product of two Bernoulli random variables. Now it turns out, and I probably should have proven that, but this is not the point. The important thing here is that if you give me one Bernoulli random variable and another one, their product will be another Bernoulli distribution, or Bernoulli variable, I should say. Right? And so that is to say the probability of xi times yi can be expressed by p square raised to the b, 1 minus p square raised to the 1 minus b. And instead of p square, I can write q. So we have q raised to the b, 1 minus q, 1 raised to the 1 minus b. So it's another Bernoulli distribution. Product of two Bernoulli variables will produce a random variable that is again Bernoulli distributed. And then if we have a sum over such products, that is, and each product is a Bernoulli variable, and we talked about it much earlier, the sum of Bernoulli variables is distributed like a binomial distribution. Right? Talked about this a couple of weeks ago. So we know that the probability of the inner product between two binary vectors like that, assuming a value of k, can only be an integer if it's a binary vector, is given by this binomial distribution. And we also talked about the expected value of binomial distributions. And yeah, this is just repeating what we worked out a couple of weeks ago. So theoretically, we would expect the value of the inner product between two random binary vectors to be given by m times p square. P again is a number between 0 and 1, some probability. And have we seen this before, like an expression like this here? Let me go back to where we saw it. It was here. Didn't call it p, but it is m times something small. And with respect to the inner product of two binary vectors, we find m dimension of the embedding space times p square. It's something small, but how small can it possibly be? Right? Can be small, but if that m curse of dimensionality becomes very, very large, then it will totally dominate this p square. So my prediction is, contrary to the random vectors we've seen earlier, that for two random binary vectors, the inner product will grow dramatically. And here it is. This is an experimental verification. I actually plot in orange the prediction I just made. And the blue curve are the outcomes of empirical experiments I did. So, do not think just because two, say, random Gaussian vectors are almost surely perpendicular, that also holds for two random binary vectors. It's not the case. I'll skip that one, it's not that cool. I'll skip it. Here is an interesting one. We already talked a lot about Gaussians in the world we're living in. We can think about 1, 2, and 3 dimensions without problems. Gaussians have all or the majority of their probability mass around the mean. Right? Now we already saw that in high dimensions everything is on the shell of a sphere, and with respect to Gaussian random variables, multivariate high dimensional Gaussian random vectors, that translates to the fact that there is nothing around the mean. There's nothing there. It's all out there. This is crazy. Okay, now we have to talk about what to do about this. We have seen a couple of examples of stuff that is going on that is beyond our daily experience and beyond our imagination. This is something, all of this can be worked out mathematically, and is a great example for the fact that I have to appeal to you to trust the equations rather than your intuition. Right? Your intuition can go horribly wrong because it is tailored towards the world we live in, and the world we live in is not a 50,000 dimensional vector space. There are many, many more such crazy phenomena. I just went through a couple of them. And with respect to pattern recognition, all of this points towards difficulties, right? So this idea of the nearest neighbor classifier, we've already basically abolished it. And that think about what all of this means with respect to the KD trees, right? Where we try to say, okay, we have this couple of points, we look for a split point. Where is that split point going to be? Right? The split point is exactly sort of the same quality as all the other points. In the examples we saw, we have, I don't know, two-dimensional distribution of points. There is some split point in the middle. In higher dimension, there's nothing in the middle. There's nothing there. So this is why these distance-based methods and KD trees are a distance-based method. They break down in higher dimensions. Everything is equally far apart. Doesn't make sense. So all of this suggests that it might be a good idea to try to force the data we are given into a lower dimension and to work with lower dimensional representations. Now, and there are many, many ways we can do this. And I will briefly recall a couple of linear techniques. And I say recall because I talk about principal component analysis, as you can see in great detail in the course on image processing. So if you have never heard of principal component analysis, what is going to follow will be very, very rough. If it is too rough for you, then watch these four videos, because what I'm going to do in 20 minutes now, typically do in four lectures, but because I typically do it in four lectures, it would be very boring for those of you who attended those lectures, I will just recall these things. If you are not so familiar with it, please watch these videos and read, I don't know, for instance, this. Okay, now, what is principal component analysis? So we are now talking about the problem of, yeah, we are given high dimensional data and we want to project it into a lower dimensional space in the hope that we can better work with a lower dimensional representation of that data. And of course, I cannot plot 50,000 dimensional data, right? So the plots that I will show you right now have, of course, nothing to do with the general problem, but it's I dissed this idea of, you know, our intuition, and now I'm appealing to our intuition, and it's, of course, rather stupid of me. But, you know, I need, you know, give you some plots. So my plots will now be two-dimensional, and of course, these two-dimensional plots cannot capture the problem we are actually talking about. But they capture what's going on in principle. Here's two-dimensional data, lives in a two-dimensional space. If you were a tiny ant and you were to crawl along the E1 dimension and look up in the sky, you would see, if I am sort of close to the origin, there is some stuff above me, but that is not so far away. If I am farther away from the origin, the stuff that is above me is farther away. So from the point of view of the ant walking along this direction, we would say this data is correlated. In the sense that a small x or ey coordinate implies a, on average, small y or e2 coordinate, and a large x coordinate implies a large y coordinate. This is what correlation means. But this is, of course, an artifact of this blue coordinate system. If we somehow could get another coordinate system, such as this orange one here, when you were a tiny ant crawling along, this direction, and you would look up and down, you would say, okay, so I'm far out, and the stuff is, you know, not so far away from me. And I'm close to the origin, and on average, the stuff is not so far away from me. And I'm far away from the origin again, and the stuff is not so far away from me. That is to say, in this orange coordinate system, the data is not correlated anymore. There is no clear pattern of small u1 coordinate implies small u2 coordinate, and large u1 coordinate implies large or whatever u2 coordinate. They are uncorrelated. So this effect of correlation in a set of data is always an effect of the coordinate system we express the data in. And one thing we could ask for, is there a coordinate system in which the data is not correlated anymore? And if we could find such a coordinate system, well, then we could express the data in such a coordinate system. I'm just exaggerating this here. Right? I said, if you are a tiny ant walking, let's really assume the point of view of the ant now. Here it looks as if the data is still expressed in this, but we can really express the data in this orange coordinate system. And in this orange coordinate system, there's no correlation. And the way we find this orange coordinate system is by means of PCA. And again, this will be rough because I'm talking about great detail in image processing. So what we are given is data, and I will very, very briefly refer to these data as ZI rather than XI. But this is because I will compute the mean of all these data points and subtract it from every data point. And the result of this subtraction will now be called XI. And geometrically, we can think of it as, okay, so we're given a cloud of data points and the mean is there. If we subtract it, the cloud moves such that the mean now coincides with the origin. This first step is to say that we turn the given data into zero mean data. And we subtract the mean, and so therefore in this X representation of the data, the mean will be zero. We then compute the covariance matrix like this, and once we are given the covariance matrix, we compute principal component analysis of that covariance matrix, which is to say we have to compute all the solutions to this eigenvector eigenvalue equation. That's to say, we're given a matrix times a vector, supposed to be the same as a scalar times a vector, which is to say that any vector that solves this is an eigenvector of that matrix, and every scalar, every corresponding scalar, is called an eigenvalue. Once again, I'll talk about this in great detail in these videos. If this matrix C is not defective, we will get m such eigenvectors, u1 all the way up to um, and can collect them as the columns in a matrix U. And we can then use U transpose times X to rotate the data such that now the data in the resulting coordinate system, like after this coordinate transformation here, will be uncorrelated. Okay, the important thing about all of this is, yeah, in our case here, the covariance matrix is always positive, semi-definite, and symmetric. Therefore, we know that the eigenvalues will be real numbers. We also know, all of these are facts I explained in these videos, we also know that if two eigenvalues are distinct, then the corresponding eigenvectors will be distinct, and not only will they be distinct, they will be in fact orthogonal. So they are all of length 1 and they are pairwise perpendicular. And if this matrix C is not defective, it's a full rank, can be inverted, blah blah blah, then it will have m independent eigenvectors. If we collect them in a matrix U like this, we know that this matrix is an element of the orthogonal group, the group of all orthogonal matrices, and members of that group in Rm have the property that if we compute U times U transpose is the same as U transpose times U. Both these operations only in this group, only for matrices in this group, will both these operations produce the identity matrix. And that is to say that matrices in the orthogonal group have the property that their transpose equals their inverse. And yet another way of thinking about principal component analysis is to say that it diagonalizes the covariance matrix from which we computed it. And that is to say that we can express this covariance matrix as a matrix factor U times lambda times U transpose, where this matrix lambda is a diagonal matrix. Along the diagonal, we find the eigenvalues. All right, a picture says 1,000 words. If we are given this covariance matrix C and compute principal component analysis, we will find two matrices U and lambda such that C can be expressed as U times lambda times U transpose, where this U, all the columns in here are orthogonal vectors. In lambda, all of this is zero and the eigenvalues are here, and this is U transpose. Okay. What is interesting for us is that this idea of decorrelation of a data set also allows for dimensionality reduction. And to see why that is, we need to look at a different picture. Now, I really, really ever so briefly, and yeah, I should not make it so rough, but again, watch those videos. I said that this matrix U of eigenvectors is a matrix in the orthogonal group of matrices, of m by m matrices. And because that is the case, we know that we can express the matrix X as the identity matrix. This is the identity matrix because U is in the orthogonal group, identity matrix times X. Now then I can sort of have a different association here. Instead of U times U transpose times X, I could think of U times U transpose times X. And I might call this matrix H. And that is to say, using principal component analysis, we can express the data matrix X we are given, and I'll assume that this is zero mean data for simplicity, can express the data matrix X we are given as U times U transpose times X. This is just the unit matrix. Very complicated way of, you know, getting the unit matrix, but it's just the identity matrix. But I can compute this product here and call it H. Right. Now, if we said that the matrix X can be expressed as U times U transpose times X, which could be understood as U times matrix H, that is to say that for every column in this matrix X, we know that column XI is U times U transpose times column XI, which is the same as
u times column hi.
So there's a one-to-one correspondence here between the columns in matrix X and the columns in matrix H, right? Now, we can then ask, okay, so what does it mean to compute u times column H of matrix H? What does it mean to compute this product here? We can say that column XI is the same as this first vector times column HI first entry, plus second vector times column HI second entry, plus third vector column HI third entry, and so on. It's to say we can express every column XI in the data matrix X as a linear combination over the columns in this matrix U. And that makes sense because we said that these entries in U, U is an M by M matrix, so it has M columns of M dimensions. We said each of these columns are orthogonal unit vectors, so they actually are basis vectors. Right? And we are just expressing this vector xi in terms of basis vectors uj. And of course we know that the coefficient we need to scale the unit vector, the basis vector uj, is just the inner product between uj and xi. This is exactly something we discussed a couple of weeks ago. All right. Now if we do this and we actually sum this expansion in terms of basis vectors from 1 up to m, we can rest assured that sort of what we get is exactly this data vector. This is cool, but if this m is 50 billion, then we have these curse of dimensionality things. We can therefore say, now what if we would not sum up to m, but select some value k, typically much less than m? That is to say, we would expand this vector xi not as a sum over all basis vectors, but just as a sum over the first k of them. Then, of course, this is not the true xi anymore. This sum where this ranges from 1 up to k, let's call it yi. It's an approximation of xi. Pictorially, we can think of this like so. Here is this matrix X, and it's now approximately a matrix uk times uk transpose times x. Uk transpose times x is hk. I'm using this subscript k to identify or point out the fact that we can think of this as truncating away a couple of columns or rows from these matrices we get out of principal component analysis. So this is a pictorial representation of what it means to truncate this sum in terms of this original matrix product. Right? We truncate those matrices. We just look at the first k columns of U, and then if we transpose it, we have a matrix of k rows, which is to say that hk will now be a matrix of k rows rather than m rows. But once again, for every vector in X, there is a corresponding vector in H. Whereas this is a five-dimensional vector, this is now a three-dimensional vector. We have reduced the dimensionality from 5 to 3, or in general from M very large to K rather small. Right. This is, of course, we will introduce an error if we do that, because we throw away information. Our question could be, what is the error we make? And in the interest of time, I will only click through this. Click, 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 click. Okay? I spent a lot of time on this slide to make sure that there is no mistake here. So I really, you know, traced all the indices and whatever, whatever. Go through this at home. Go through this. Everything I say here, and you know, use the fact of the clicks. So go for it, like click by click, right? It makes sense, and it says the error we make, the average. This is now I'm using epsilon here. I should have used this average thing, but anyway, the average truncation error we make actually is the sum of the eigenvalues we've thrown away. This is great because principal component analysis provides us with a number that tells us how good our low dimensional representation, 3 instead of 5, represents the original data. Right? And that is the error we make, the sum over the eigenvalues we throw away. Okay, in practice, we can then use that to actually determine a good K. We compute principal component analysis of a set of data, then we have all the eigenvalues, and then we can sum J up to K and J up to M, and look at the ratio and say, well, if this approximation, if the ratio between the approximation and the real thing exceeds, say, 90% or 95%, something like that, then that K is a good thing. Typically, if we look at the spectrum of eigenvalues, it looks like this, and we then sort of have a cutoff here. The mass under this curve up until some K here will be larger than 90%, and that's a good approximation. Okay, that was rough, but once again, I spend a lot of time on this in the previous semester. Look at these videos if you have never heard of PCA. If you have already heard of it, it should be just a reminder. One thing that needs to be noted with respect to PCA is that it is really, really, really a very powerful approach, has its limitations, but is a very good baseline, but for high dimensional data can be expensive. There are faster ways of doing it, but even these faster ways can be expensive. So if the data is really, really high dimensional, and I'm talking about really high dimensional, so beyond 10,000, that can be at least a cup of coffee will pass until that thing has computed PCA, and lots of coffees will need to be drank to wait for really high dimensional principal component analysis. For mathematicians, they don't care. I actually say PCA people in theoretical computer science consider PCA to be so simple that everything that builds on top of it is the stuff that needs to be reduced in complexity, because PCA, even if it takes 5 days, it's so well understood and simple, it does not factor into the complexity of an. I'm careful about these things because these people hardly ever work with real data. You know, if you do research with pen and paper, then it's cool. But if you have to wait 5 days until PCA has been computed, that's rather frustrating. So, long story short, in very, very, very high dimensions, and in really very high dimensions now, that can be very tedious, and there is another way. And that other way is actually recurring to something we talked about today. Now, from the way I talked about the use of PCA in dimensionality reduction earlier, it's not quite as clear, but when we compute this matrix UK transpose times X to get this matrix H, the low dimensional representation of the data, we compute that, that is to say that we project the data from M dimensions into K dimensions. Right? This is this thing here. This computation here, this matrix product, is a projection from 5 to 3. It's a projection, it's a linear operation, it projects the data from a 5-dimensional space in this example to a 3-dimensional space. And that is to say, if we're interested in linear dimensionality reduction, this is always, can always be thought of in terms of a projection matrix applied to the data to get a low-dimensional representation of that data.
One question we could ask is, what is a good projection matrix? Like, why does PCA work so well? That's a good question. I have to stress, PCA is a linear method and it works well under all the sort of confinements we usually have for linear methods, right? If the data is highly nonlinear, then linear methods will not work so well, but it's fast and easy to understand. So, but for linear methods, it is always projections. What properties should these projection matrices have? Now, reasonable idea is to say if we are given two data points in the original high dimensional space, we want to find two data points in a low dimensional space, and the distance between them should be the same. Can we expect that to happen, given what we discussed earlier? Very unlikely, right? In very high dimensional spaces, they are all at the same distance, and in low dimensional space, there's not enough space to squeeze them all to the same distance. So therefore, this is hardly ever equal. So therefore, approximation. Now, these low dimensional representations result from projecting the original high dimensional ones. And we can sort of factor out this matrix. We get P times xi minus xj. And then we can expand this squared Euclidean distance, which leads to xi minus xj transpose times p times xi minus xj. And we want the stuff on the right-hand side to be as similar or close or equal to the stuff on the left-hand side as possible. Right here, I have just expanded this squared Euclidean distance in terms of this inner product between this vector difference. And here there is this projection matrix in between, P transpose times P. For the right-hand side to be as equal to the left-hand side as possible, that would mean that this matrix P transpose times P has to be the identity matrix. Right? If that was the case, then everything is cool. And therefore, the quest in linear dimensionality reduction is to find a projection matrix P such that P transpose times P is as identity matrixy as possible, I should say. I, of course, cannot work, right? Because a rank argument here. But to wrap this up, one can show that if the columns or rows, that depends on how you see P or P transpose, of this matrix P are orthogonal, pairwise orthogonal, then P transpose times P at least comes close to the unit matrix. Right? I'm not showing this here, but a good thing is to have a projection matrix whose rows are as orthogonal as possible. With respect to PCA, we have that for guarantee, because the eigenvectors in that matrix are orthogonal. We know that. So therefore, PCA works perfectly, because we know they will be orthogonal. We just saw that very high dimensional random vectors are also orthogonal. And that boils down to the interesting observation that in very high dimensions, and I'm talking 10 to the fifth and higher, you don't have to compute PCA. You just generate a couple of random vectors and use these random vectors in your projection matrix. And that can actually be made precise. And look at this, we have another probability of something bad has to be small things here. This is called the distributional Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma, and I will not look under the hood here. I'm just saying that this really rough sketch of the idea, hey, in very high dimensions, let's just use, I don't know, k randomly generated vectors of unit length to project the data into a low dimensional space in very high dimensions, that actually works. Right? And there's a really deep mathematical principle behind this. And look at this. When we set out discussing everything today, I said, you know, we talked about this Wapnick-Cervonenkis dimension, and at the very end of today's lecture we have another mathematical thing. We will definitely not look into the details, which however strangely resembles the things we studied when we looked into learning theory. Okay, we now know about the curse of dimensionality and at least a couple of its manifestations, and we have reminded ourselves about the idea of principal component analysis and its use in dimensionality reduction, and the fact that in really high dimensions we don't even have to bother computing PCA, we just compute random unit vectors and use them to project the data into lower spaces. But really, in 100 dimensions, that does not work. But if it's like 100,000 dimensions, you know, random projections work beautifully. Great. This is all I have for today. Do you have any questions? If not, really, please, take the stuff we discussed today to your hearts. Later on in life, don't become one of those idiots, and there are plenty of those. You know, we extract this kind of feature, then we extract that kind of feature, and then I have like five different modalities to describe this image, and we just concatenate them, and this gives us a 200 million dimensional feature vector, and then we train a support vector machine, and those people don't even know what they are doing. And the scientific literature is full of useless results. These kind of things should have never been published scientifically because those people don't know what they're doing. But many reviewers as well don't know about the field they represent. And that is one of the benefits and downsides studying here, is that you learn about these things. This is good because you will become better practitioners than a lot of people out there, but it is bad because you always have to tell the idiots later on in your lives, no, don't do it like this. Because you know that certain things need to be done with care. Great, so thank you and see you next week.